Well, here's my next project sitting on the table here, since it's a little bit wide and deep for the bench at the moment. This is something a little bit different than what I've previously worked on, although it is a receiver of the same vintage. It is a Sanyo PLUS 130. Or Sanyo PLUS series PLUS 130. This is a very rare unit. By some estimates, there were less than 1,500 made in the world. And it is secondary only to a unit that never actually saw production, which was the PLUS 200. This one is rated at 130 watts per channel. I don't know if the 200 was actually rated at 200 watts per channel or not. But this one is rated at 130. And I bought this from a guy who had been working on it for a while. And basically the issue, as he describes it, is something with the left channel. He just could not get the left channel working. And the preamp worked, everything, according to him, everything else worked, the tuner and everything else. But he could not, for some reason, get the left channel to work at all. So I don't normally like working on previously worked on stuff. But again, this is just kind of a rare piece and I wanted to take a stab at it. So first thing I'm going to do is open it up and just kind of take a quick look around. It's got some cosmetic dings and dents, but it's not too terrible. There's a few little dings on the corners here, and there's a couple of dings in the wood case as well. But overall, it's in pretty decent condition. So I'm going to take a look inside and see what I can find. Well, I've got this thing open, and I'm inspecting the left channel, which appears to have had a lot of repair work done on it in the past. I've noticed a few things already. First of all, the way the system was connected when I received it, everything was installed in here, and the wires coming from this amp board to this board, the connectors were all flipped around 180 degrees from what appears that they should have been, based on the way they seem to fit properly, as well as the way that the right channel ones are installed. So that may be an issue, because we've got not only just output transistors on here, but we've got a bias diode, as well as a small, what appears to be a thermal compensating unit or a thermistor or something like that. It's also installed on here. And if this were swapped, for example, so that a plus 54 was being fed into one side of the bias diode and the other side was in circuit or something, definitely could cause some issues. And I don't know exactly how this was installed, and these aren't labeled. Usually when I take off a bunch of connectors that look similar, I label them. Either, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 across the board or something like that. So these aren't labeled, so I'm probably going to have to trace out the schematic to figure out how they're supposed to be installed and make sure they're installed correctly. Also, I'm hoping this little bias diode is good, because these are very expensive. I think they're about $35 a piece to get a brand new one. So I'm hoping it's good. My meter can test up to 2 volts, I believe, on diode settings, so I should be able to test that diode. And then all these transistors, I don't know if they're any good. If those wires were swapped around, things could have gotten shorted very quickly. So I've got that. I'll have to test those transistors as well as those other components. And then on this board, we've got an area where there's definitely been some burning and scorching. There's some burn marks on this emitter resistor. There's some burn marks down here on the board. These resistors may have been replaced, or whatever these are. I'm going to have to try and figure out what they are, if they are, in fact, resistors or something else. The regulator appears to be in good shape. The rectifier, rather, appears to be in good shape. And a lot of these wire wraps have been undone and then re-soldered again. So I'm gonna have to hope that this is correct, or start tracing that out as well. So looks like the board has been recapped already, which is nice. I don't know if that was a repair effort or just this is when it all started. I'm not sure. And if you flip the back of the board over, you can see that there's been a lot of soldering done on here. There's that transistor where that hole is actually out on this side, and it's kind of oddly tucked into here. I'm not exactly sure why this wire is running over here. This is factory. This is the same as what's on the right channel board there. So that's factory. And then there's also a diode here on this side of the board as well. And this resistor here too. So I'll have to try and figure out what's going on with that. It looks like that resistor may have gone from here to here. So I'll have to see what I can do about that. But I don't think it's an impossible project. Should be able to figure it out, hopefully. Well, I'm going to start by testing components and maybe get a mouse order put in before tomorrow so I can have the parts midweek next week if I can get the order in tonight. So let me go ahead and start testing components and see what I can come up with. Well, I've gotten the circuit board straightened out, at least as far as getting components mounted nicely and things like that. Cleaned up solder joints and did a few other things. I'm going to still have to clean this board off, but I've kind of got it, you know, 90% of the way there, and I'm ready to start doing some testing. And I traced out each trace going to these connectors because I wasn't sure what went where, and they didn't seem to fit on the way they were installed when I received it. So I started fooling around, and I got the connectors installed the way they're actually wired in the schematic, but I actually cannot get... everything is stretched on this board. And I started thinking to myself, why does everything need to be so stretched out to make it work right as far as the schematic? And I actually realized that this heatsink is turned around backwards. On the other side, all you see is heatsink, and the output transistors are actually under there. But on this side, they're out to the side, and so this heatsink unit is actually mounted backwards. So I'm going to have to turn that around so that I can actually have the wires where they're supposed to be. So let me go ahead and do that. Let's see if that makes things fit just a tad bit better. Well, I've got everything straightened out with that heatsink, and I remounted everything properly. Just had to spin this unit 180 degrees, turned around, and was able to mount the output transistors as I think they're supposed to be, considering that the right channel looks like that, and that one hasn't been touched as far as I can tell. So I was a little disappointed to find out there's some kind of major dings on this heatsink, but at least the Freon portion is sealed up real nicely and doesn't have any damage, so to speak. There is actually Freon in this tube, and when the outputs, which are below here, heat up, there's some kind of junction or one way in there, and it causes the Freon to move up into here, and then it dissipates the heat in these fins, and then it cools back to liquid and moves back down into the bottom, and kind of the process repeats, and the thing just cycles like this. So hopefully you know, I don't see any leaks, and it appears to be full of Freon there. So I've got this hooked up to my dim bulb tester here, and I'm gonna give it a shot. Well, looks like it's pulling about 30 or 40 watts, considering the bulb is actually pretty dim. Oh, I got some lights. Not hearing a protection relay, though. Let me see what I can do about that. There we go. Yeah, it's only drawing about 65 watts right now. Let's see. Huh. You got lights and all sorts of stuff going on here. I got display. Let's see what my DC offset is. That's about 1 millivolt. Yeah. I was trying to balance that pot in the center when I was working on the circuit board. 1 millivolt or so. That's not bad at all. Let's see if I can get something to play out of here. Sound. Actually sounds pretty good. Left channel. Actually it's working pretty good. Believe it or not. Yeah, sitting about 12 millivolts of DC offset, which is not bad. I'll probably tweak that later, but there's 1 millivolt when I turned it on, so I don't know. Just getting warm or what. But, man, at least I know it's working. Well, I gotta stop listening to it this and actually get it finished fixing. Sounds pretty good, though, honestly, the way it is, but there's probably a bit more distortion there needs to be in the left channel, because I'm feeling these heat sinks. This is the left over here. This heat sink is still cold to the touch, and this is the right channel, and it's, I haven't been playing it all that loud. This is, the metal doesn't feel cold anymore. It feels room temperature, whereas this metal actually feels still cold to the touch, as metal does in the basement. So I'm thinking the bias on here is set to probably minimum, if anything, and so there's probably more distortion in that channel than there needs to be at this point, although I've been listening to it and you really can't hear it. It sounds pretty good. Well, I didn't make a video clip of adjusting the bias, but it's not very difficult, and I would imagine anyone would be able to do that. So I've got that adjusted, and the two channels play pretty evenly and generate about the same amount of heat. But I was turning it off and on a few times and started to have a problem where one or the other channel wouldn't come on when I first turned on the receiver, and I'd have to crank up the volume quite a bit, and then both channels would play okay. And I've traced the problem to, this is the speaker panel from the back. It's actually its own separate little panel that pops out if you look at it. There's the speaker jacks. All the wiring comes to this panel. And then this board that's on here is the protection circuit. And I've actually traced the problem to some corrosion on this relay here. This is a Fujitsu FRL 264 D024/04AL-01, which is a fairly common Fujitsu model of relay. Now, I don't have that brand, and you can't really buy these anymore, but I've got this fairly common Omron model, which is a MY4-02 24 volt DC, and the only thing about this is it's got the two sets of pins, so you got dual pole, and I'm going to have to cut off this last row of pins because they're not used and there's no holes for them on this board. And then you can see you just got the three and the last row is not connected. So I'm going to have to do that. But the biggest issue I'm running into right now is the fact that the pins from the speaker jacks are actually mounted through this board and come out here. Which means I'm going to have to unsolder or unwire wrap some of these wires to actually get this board off the speaker jack mounting that it's on here in order to unsolder this relay. This is a small gap, less than half an inch, and I'm not going to be able to reach my equipment in there, and if I did, I'd probably just tear up the board. So I think the better option is to label these wires properly, what channel they go to and what they do, unsolder, unwrap them, and I would normally just unsolder the pin they're on, but I can't even get to that, so I'm going to have to do it from the top side here. Unsolder them, unwrap them, take the board off of the speaker jacks that it's mounted on, do the relay replacement, probably replace these two caps while I'm at it, just because of preventative reasons, and then re-solder the board back down, re-wrap the connections I had to take off and go from there. Probably give them a fresh coat of solder, since we all know that when you take wrapping off, it never goes back on, and if it does, it'll probably break. So I'll just solder those to the pins once I'm done. And then I should be good to go. But I gotta do that. I gotta get this new relay installed, and it's gonna be a pain. So that's the next task. I'm still working on this Sanyo PLUS 130 receiver, and I've got the amplifier section straightened out. That relay has been replaced, and what I'm kind of working on right now is trying to address the somewhat poor reception of the tuner, and specifically the FM tuner. I really don't get many AM stations around here, and so I'm not really sure how it performs, but the FM tuner is definitely lacking in many areas. Even the strongest station I get here, which is a country station out of northern Delaware, is actually very weak on this radio. So I've got my Sencor hooked up, and I'm running in frequency sweep mode here, and I've got that attached to the front end of the tuner, and then I've got my probe here on a couple of points, and I'm running through this. Now, I'm no tuner expert, I'll be real honest. I can inject signals and tweak things, but I'm doing this section up here for the IF, which seems to be pretty important. This uses a 10.7 megahertz IF, which is very, very common in FM equipment. Occasionally you'll see something that deviates from that very slightly, from what I've read, but 10.7 megahertz is by far the standard. And right now what I'm working on is this detector alignment, and I'm trying to make my scope look like this picture. I think I've got it pretty close. I had to adjust a couple of these little cans slightly, and that's the image I'm going for. There you can see. I don't know why I wouldn't focus there. Apparently the scope image, the scope is throwing off the focus of the camera or something, but that's what I'm going for, and it looks pretty darn good. This is a 4-gang FM, 2-gang AM tuner. The AM tuner sounds like absolute trash around here, but to be real honest, I only get one station faintly, and I get a lot of noise from the military base that is within a few miles from here. They're pretty much covers the entire AM spectrum, and I don't get any stations there, but it doesn't seem to affect FM very much. So I want the FM to at least work. So I got that, and I've done this one, which I've got also. So now I need to get my frequency counter out and start working on the quartz tuning section, because this does have a actually rather nice quartz lock features. Right now it's not locked because I don't have anything coming in the front end from the antenna, but also this wouldn't lock anyway because it's too far up the spectrum, but I need to work on that a little bit, so work on that next. But this is a pretty cool receiver to work on. I'm really happy with it, and hopefully I can get the tuner sensitivity to be a little bit better, and that'll be nice too. So that's the plan at this point. Well, this Sanyo PLUS 130 receiver has kind of parked itself on the bench in an almost permanent fashion, and I've been fooling around trying to get the radio, the tuner, to work a little bit better. And basically what I've come up with is the fact that the ceramic filters in here are absolutely terrible. Many are not centered on 10.7 megahertz, or if they are centered on it, they have a much different frequency response, one side of 10.7 versus the other, or something of that nature. So what I'm doing is I'm actually putting in some sockets into the tuner in place of the 10.7 megahertz filters, and there's four filters in the FM section. And then what I'm doing is I'm going to be able to change out the filters and kind of find the best combination, maybe put some newer filters in there. I put in an order from DigiKey for some new filters. I got them right here. I ordered 10 of each style, so I have 280 kilohertz, 230, 180, and 150 width, and I'm assuming I'll use the more narrow ones in the narrow band, and then the wider ones just for the wide, which is CF1 and 4. So right now I'm installing these little sockets. So basically what I've done is I've chopped up an IC socket into little 3-pin sections and then kind of sanded down the plastic on the ends to make it less sharp. And I'm going to install these in place of the filters, and then I can change them very easily. So that's kind of what I'm working on at the moment, and we'll see if I can get the response of this tuner a little bit better. Certainly, if it doesn't make it any better by changing new filters, I can at least put the original filters back into the sockets in their original spaces, and the performance should be at least back to where it was. So right now I've got the tuner kind of unmounted. I've taken off the pulley, which is dangerous in and of itself, but this receiver is kind of just something I want to work on for a while, and I want to get it as good as I can, so I'm willing to take some risks. It's not like I have anyone waiting for it or anything like that. So I've got this one here installed, and I've got another filter here. See if I can get a little closer. These two were blue. This is a filter here. That's CF3, and then CF4 is right here. So I've got those four filters to change. Well, I'm still working on this receiver. I really need to get this thing off the bench. It's probably going to become one of those projects that I could spend years fiddling with, but I just need to get it to a point where it's good and get it off the bench. I messed with the radio, put those filters in a little bit more, and it's actually not too bad right now. If I switch over to go to like FM or something, and I can actually get some pretty good reception here in the basement with just a wire running up to the ceiling there. I get some pretty good reception, getting good quartz lock on the different frequencies, and I can tune in, there's 101.1 there, and then this one I get a bar there, that's pretty good. Up to 102.7 is a good station, got that, and then 137 is really strong, and I got that, and any sound alright. I'm not going to fool with the radio anymore, though. But what I just finished doing, and I did not take a video of it, is I took this tone amp board out, and I completely recapped it, and I also put all new transistors on it, because I was having just a really odd issue with some kind of oscillating feedback, but it was very low frequency feedback, like below 60 hertz. The oscillation was like 30 or 40 hertz. It was almost inaudible, but I could see the speaker, the woofers vibrating in and out. And these are actually decent speakers in my workshop. They're Klipsch Icons, which, you know, I don't know if I'd do my hi-fi audiophile listening with them, but they work awesome for, you know, speakers just to enjoy music and test receivers in the workshop and all that. But at the same time, I don't want to destroy them. So I was kind of worried about that. But so far, I've been playing around with this, listening to music and the radio. Got my computer hooked up. Haven't put all the knobs back on yet. But so far, I've not seen any further signs of that. So I don't know if I had a failing cap. It was intermittent in both channels. It seemed to be worse in the right channel. But it also seemed to occur in the left channel whenever the right channel started going. It would eventually kind of start happening in the left channel within a few seconds as well. So that seems to have cured that. Well, this is kind of my final video with this Sanyo PLUS Series 130 receiver. I think I've kind of taken it as far as I really can. It's a nice amplifier. As far as the tuner goes, I would say it is below average, despite the fact that it has a 4-gang FM tuner. It has a fairly garbage AM tuner, and I think maybe somebody who's very, very good with tuners might be able to squeeze a little bit more performance out of it, but as it is, it's not going to be taken very far. The FM is working pretty decent. This is not a stereo station. It sounds pretty nice. It seems to kind of quartz lock when there isn't really a station sometimes, but there's a little bit of kind of buzz or hum in it too. I also don't get a lot of FM reception down in the basement. This country station comes in pretty well. Really well, actually. You get 4 bars out of that. Or 5 bars, rather. And then get a few other stations. There's something there, too. Oh, the sports station. I get a decent signal out of that, too, actually. So the FM is working acceptably, at least for the basement. So that appears to be working. The AM reception around here is garbage to begin with, and this is not helping. It's a very, very cheaply done AM tuner. Just basically a single IC. The LA1240 is the part. It basically does about 90% of the work there in that integrated circuit. So the FM actually is a little bit better of a mechanism. Not great again, but better. But I think I've tweaked this AM as good as I can get. I have replaced those little trimmer capacitors here, and I've adjusted them to kind of peak the best signal that I'm going to get out of the AM. Those are both for the AM, actually, there. Kind of provides, you got your 2 gangs, and then it provides just a little bit more adjustment, basically. So that's kind of where we're at with this thing. Cover is just going to go back on, and I think at that point it's pretty much kind of going to be out the door. Other than that, the tape functions, and it's got a moving coil and a moving magnet phono input, which is very nice. Separate functions for that, and auxiliary and tape functions, a dubbing back and forth high filter. I might need to clean the potentiometer for the volume here too, actually. I thought about that too. But that's it for this thing.